Okay, so my question for you is about Noah's Ark. I think it's kind of interesting because, like I said, sometimes these topics are taboo in the Christian church, especially big church, because there's so many different ideas and they don't want people fighting about this. And sometimes I ask apologists this, and I'm surprised that sometimes, like, I think Fazil Rana, you know, at Reasons to Believe, I think even he said, like, well, you know, I'm not a theologian. And I'm thinking, do you need to be a theologian to understand this story? I mean, why is this story so complicated? Is it a worldwide flood? Is it a local flood? Or is it a myth? Those are three main positions. And some apologists, like this other guy I talked about, he went to seminary, a different guy. It's like they say, well, they want to punt on it by saying they're not a theologian. So I'm thinking, why is this such a complicated question? I mean, it's a Bible story. What's how could anybody who's in the pew understand this when a person with a seminary degree says, you know, I don't have a, they don't think they're a theologian enough to understand it. I don't get it.
Well, I mean, I guess I know what I would say is that I'm not a theologian enough to give a explanation that satisfactorily answers every question I have about it. So as I look at it, you know, do I see it as a historical account? Yes. So I don't think it's a mythological account, that there was a real flood, that there was a boat that saved humanity and the animals from judgment, that was an outgrowth of how evil the world had become, and that was God's judgment on the humanity. Now, in every one of those, you know, the question is global, you know, as in covered the whole globe, or is it local in that it didn't cover the whole globe? And then there's a question of, did it cover all of humanity or not? In every one of those, there are, you know, theological and interpretational and scientific questions, and there's data that weighs in on all of those, and it's difficult to find a way that reconciles all of that. And if you're going to argue that it's mythological, there's also textual difficulties with that. And so I think it's a reflection of the obvious aspect of the story is that God was judging humanity because of how evil and depraved they had become, and he was saving a certain segment of the population, and it was about how much God hates sin. Now, when you get into the details of how exactly did this work, that's where it gets a little more complicated. And again, I would say I can tell you what my position is, but I also know there are questions in there that I don't have good answers to in my position. So,
well, I can maybe think that, you know, if a person like the evolutionary creationist who says the Bible doesn't say anything about science or whatever, you know, somebody who says it's basically a myth, it's just to teach theology, I could see somebody saying that, and then there's no conflict because it wasn't meant to be a literal story. So how can you have a conflict then?
But that, like I said, there are textual difficulties because if that's myth, is Abraham myth? There's no place where you transition from the mythological stories to the actual historical stories. And so, you know, from a textually, how do you interpret scriptural consistently? That raises some problems.
I think they basically would just say, look at the whole Bible as, don't, you know, just don't go to it for history. I mean, you know, the big picture, and this is why I couldn't stay in it anymore, but basically the big picture is, you know, that you're a sinner and Jesus came and died on the cross for your sins. And if you believe that, you're going to have eternal life and go to heaven and, you know, serve the Lord. And don't worry about all the details. I don't know. I guess for me and maybe for you, you're saying no, I'm sorry. The Bible is obvious. It's trying to tell a story here. And it sounds like this person who says it's a myth just isn't, they're compromising too much.
Well, and I wouldn't say it's compromising. It's as I look at how the structure of Genesis is laid out, to say that the flood is a myth, then you have problems with, is Abraham a myth, and is the Exodus a myth? And there are all these things. It's like there's no place where that the textual clues would say, oh, this is myth and this is history. And So it presents some textual interpretational difficulties to just declare it a myth.
Okay. Last one. You have a short question for me?